All right, so our next speaker is the CEO of FSM, that's the Friends of Science and Medicine, not the Flying Spaghetti Monster. She's a steadfast campaigner against the influence of pseudoscience in medicine, and she'll be talking about the rise of pseudoscience in academic medicine and her efforts to do something about that. Please welcome Loretta Marron.
Pseudoscience is going gangbusters in Australia. Every corner you turn, there's some new therapist setting up their computer and everything. Here we are, 21st century, and it's just no stopping it. $4 billion industry now. And I started with these talks of $3 billion, so it's continuing to grow. But that's a lot of jobs, a lot of taxes coming in, a lot of lobbying, a lot of reasons for the politicians to want to look the other way. Now, it's largely promoted by particularly the complementary medicine field. They're, some cases, Swiss and Blackmores together, are putting $50 million per annum per year in advertising. Nicole Kidman, Cadell Evans, the cyclist, Mark Webber, Formula One, the list goes on. Ricky Ponting, just all these people that we know and trust, all promoting these products. And advertising is very effective. Just about everybody's got something in their head. Now, of the 11,000, if you want to advertise a complementary medicine in our country, it has to have a little listing number. So you have to pay a little bit of money and send in a request for a listing number to the Therapeutic Goods Administration. And they will give you a listing number and you put it on your product. Now, of the 11,000 complementary medicines, only 200 have ever been tested. There's a devices as well, there's high-risk devices, which is a new hip x-ray machine, and there's also a category called low-risk devices. Now, if you have a device in Europe and it has a safety certificate, the TGA is required by law to accept your device onto the register. All the requirement is these products, goods are safe. There is no requirement for anybody to prove that they were not. And what we have is unregistered practitioners, and I believe some registered practitioners who are not medical, probably medically trained, diagnosing and treating patients out of the area of expertise. In our country, you cannot advertise a prescription drug, but you can say anything you want about a complementary medicine, and there is no effective way of stopping. There is a complaint system called TGA Complaints Resolution Panel. They take up to 6 months to look at that complaint, and then the people can totally ignore it. Say there's no incentive for them to stop. Your system here, I give it a plug, the Advertising Standards Authority is much better than our system. There's two types of pseudoscience. There's first of all the belief systems that defy the laws of physics and physiology. And then there's those interventions that do actually provide some benefit, but the claims are blown out of proportion. A lot of these therapies here, or interventions here, I think you've heard about, a lot of them are based on the concept of physics and energy. Now, we have a case of words like prana, ki, chi, life force, vital force, innate energy. The list goes on. And then we have the concept that some of your external body parts are connected to your organs. And then we've got myriads of channels through our bodies. And the idea that you're sick because your cells are deficient in energy, or you're sick because of some sort of energy blockage. We have, for example, reflexology, where the channels are from the hands and the feet to the organs. We've got auriculotherapy, which is really neat. They've got little body parts all on your ear, and that's connected to the organs. We've got iridology, where the mapping of the eye to the organs. We've got Reiki, where you transfer your life force energy to your patient, going from one person to the other to actually heal. We've also got things like with acupuncture, where it's coming in and out of your skin at all sorts of different points, because you've got too much energy, or not enough energy, or energy blockages. So pretty well based on all this. Now this energy has never been proven to exist. Much of naturopathy, we have a university degree in health science, naturopathy, the textbook is all of it. And Chinese traditional medicine. Lots of stuff there about qi and channels and meridians and all that kind of stuff as well. Then we have things like tai chi, hypnotherapy, massage, and meditation. Great stuff, can benefit some people, but they do not change the course of any disease. Now let me be clear. Not all these practitioners are even terrible people and should be sent off to some penal colony. Some of them are doing really good work. They spend a lot of time with patients, so they offer them psychological support. But when they work particularly with weight loss, Australia, I believe, could be currently the fattest country in the world. It seems to shift between those of Mexico and America and the UK. We're a hugely overweight population. We definitely need people to work with weight loss. So if they stick with that, and massage, of course, is a lovely thing for people to have, they could certainly benefit people. Now, if you meet these complementary therapists or alternative therapists, they're lovely people. You couldn't get nicer people. They do care about their patients. And I just wish they'd all be nurses, because we're certainly short of those. So these good people, so they're not all trying to exploit people. They're not all trying to do wrong. However, if you confront them with the evidence, they don't want to believe it, they'll ignore it. They're set in their ways and they'll just keep going on and on and on with things that just don't work. And in reality, the biggest risk, most people that go to them are the worried, well, they're fine. But what if you go there and got a lump on your breast and they tell you that they can massage it away and it's cancer? What if you're a diabetic? What if you bring your child in? There was a child with autism brought to a chiropractor. $40,000 it cost the parents. And all that did for that child is delay speech therapy. So you can either make your illness worse, or you can actually, that child may never reach its full potential because of this. Now, they confiscated a number of Chinese traditional medicines at border control in the country, and they sent them off to be DNA tested. And they found that they contained the DNA of endangered species, of toxic plants, they were laced with prescription drugs. So if you go to your Chinese practitioner, you may not know what you're getting in there. And then, of course, it's the stuff that you buy in your health food shop or your pharmacy. You can't tell a drug where you go, and we're all different. There's a woman in South Australia who's on a second liver transplant because she took black colour wash for hot flashes. The stuff doesn't even work anymore. So they can be quite dangerous. We have the biggest inland city in Australia is threatening to shut down their cancer clinic. There's just not enough money to fund it. The health dollar is so tight, you cannot afford to waste it. And that's exactly what's happening. The government indirectly and directly is funding a lot of these therapies. And then, of course, we have the situation where you decide you don't want to vaccinate your child. And they come home as whooping cough. What about the newborn baby next door that catches it and could die? There are babies now dying of vaccine-preventable diseases. We're getting plagues or many areas where there's like 150 patients catching measles. Two articles on measles in the paper in the last week. And a third of the patients are ending up in hospital. That's a huge cost. Very expensive, yes. Hundreds of thousands of dollars spent in potentially useless complementary medicines. I mean, if your doctor says you're deficient, that's one thing. But if you just go there and think, oh, I'll buy all this stuff, you could well be wasting money. And the problem is, if you've got cancer and you delay, sometimes there's a small window of opportunity to get that disease. And if you waste that, you could have the disease could spread, more time in the hospital, bigger surgery, more time away from your family, cost to the community as well. So there are some actual real costs, both direct and indirect costs, for turning away from the advice your doctor gives you or ignoring it. Now that's the backdrop to Friends of Science and Medicine. Our little logo there is the aim is to foster good science and medicine. So it takes a while to come up with something so short. We're happy with that. Now I'd like to introduce my fellow co-founders. John Dwyer, he actually ran the Department of Medicine at the University of New South Wales, a very prestigious university. He actually is an immunologist. He saw his HIV/AIDS patients robbed blind before they died when AIDS came to our country. And he thought, well, this just wasn't right. That's part of his passion. Alison McLennan, gynecologist and obstetrician. He could see his pregnant ladies swallowing all these herbal remedies, and he was concerned about the effect on them, their fetuses, and even the long-term effect on the babies. Rob Morrison is a science communicator. His concern is from the dumbing down of science in schools and in universities and technical colleges. Marcello Costa is a neurophysiologist. He contacted me. He said, look, I want my university students to learn about cancer. Not as a fact, just about it. Can you find me an academic across Australia who's not gone to the dark side? We never found one. There just wasn't one. They were all had alternative beliefs. And there's myself. Looks a funny slide when they put us all up together. All these guys have got a lot of alphabet after them. Two new team members have come on recently, which is fantastic. Increased the good looks of the groups and lowers the age considerably is Joanne, who's the doctor, nurse, and Sue, who's an emergency doctor. So they've just come on board and they've hit the ground running. So the thing is, well, what are we about? Well, what we are committed to is trying to make sure that if there's a course on health in the university, that it is based on science. So we're trying to wind back some of these fairly questionable courses that are going on there. Now, a lot of my history has been out in the battlefield, targeting alternative therapists and people supporting them. With this group, we're trying to work at a higher level. We're trying to engage with politicians and regulatory bodies and anybody of influence, like the chief medical officer or science officers, and just to alert them to the real and potential harm of ignoring what's happening in our country. Now, the rumour is that we're against everything to do with complementary medicine. Well, in reality, in Europe, they've grown forests, or they used to grow forests of the yew tree, European yew tree. as a chemotherapy drug until they could synthesize it. In reality, the cure for cancer could be in a forest here in New Zealand. If there is a Maori traditional remedy that has good anecdotal evidence, test it. You know, what a great income that would be for the country. So we're certainly interested, and a lot of modern medicine came out of nature. So we are very interested in keeping that research, keeping it in the universities. That's the right place to work. And we think every healthcare student should have an understanding about CAM, as I say, not as a fact, so they can effectively talk to their patients. Now I'll jump a little bit aside here because this is my talk, so I'm going to talk about where I started in the formation of this organisation. Up until 2010, July 2010, I actually primarily stuck to natural therapists, you know, the naturopaths and those sorts of people. I didn't bother going near chiropractic. Because if you put in a complaint against claims they were making, well, the board was full of people that believed them. There was no point, we were wasting the time. But in July 1, they set up a group called the Australian Health Practitioners Regulation Agency, and they were to look after or to put a central register for 10 registered groups like nurses, doctors, physiotherapists, and chiropractors were being included in that group. Now, the little line that really impressed me in the dialogue on the website was that they were partnering in the regulation of chiropractors. And I thought, you beauty, at long last, there's a body above them that they may be accountable to. So, this was gung-ho for me. I thought I found a new project. So the first thing I did, I sat down on my trusty keyboard with the worn-out paint on the keys, and I went through and I documented, I listed every website in Australia that had any claims for chiropractic. As long as it made a claim, not just directing to a clinic, had to make any sort of health claim. Then I put them in order of state. There were 51 in New South Wales, so I sat down and actually submitted a report on this. Now, when you put a complaint in, you have to actually print the page out that has the comment on it. They're not going to take the word for it. Now, as chiropractic, they put one page per health condition. So the report for these 51 websites was like 3 centimetres thick, and I just split it in two, and I sent that in. I also looked at Queensland, and it was the same thing. All these sorts of claims have been made, and they were all the same. They were all that chiropractic could assist, or cure, or treat ADHD, asthma, allergies, bedwetting, colic, and ear infection. Same for Queensland, same for Victoria. And I thought, this is rather unusual. Why are they all making those claims? I hadn't expected that. Now, move the clock forward to March 2001. Now, this is one of those pure, wonderful coincidences where our stars lined up. Unbeknownst to me, the Australian skeptics were investigating courses in our 39 universities. March, they actually produced a report showing that nearly half had potentially pseudoscience in their either courses or in their degrees. That very same month, I was thinking about chiropractic and why they were all making the claims, and it dawned on me, I thought, maybe they're teaching it in their universities. Now, there were 3 universities that did chiropractic. One was Royal Melbourne Institute of Technology, another that's in Victoria, very prestigious university. Then was Macquarie University in New South Wales and Loretta here in West Australia. So I looked at the Royal Melbourne, the RMIT, to find they had one guy, their head of department, was talking about this new chiropractic, pediatric chiropractic clinic. And I thought, well, that doesn't sound too good. Why would you need a pediatric chiropractic clinic? Oh, that many kids get hit the heads. And I thought, well, I better see who's running the clinic. So I found out who was running the clinic, looked at their personal websites. And there it was, at our clinic, we treat ADHD, asthma, allergies, bedwetting, colic, and ear infection. Looked at another one, same thing. So I could see that this pediatric chiropractic clinic, no matter what they taught in a degree, these students were being exposed to these chiropractors. So I wrote a report to the health minister, getting used to these thick reports, sent it in with all my evidence. And whenever I write a report, I always ask for expert opinion because I'm not medical. So I have 3 or 4 professors giving me their expert opinion. Send it to the pediatric chiropractic clinic. And what I also do is, I also send it to the press. So I have particular journalists who are very happy to receive a report from me. So my report not only went to the Health Minister, it also got mentioned in the Medical Journal of Australia as well. So that really worked out well. And what that also meant, skeptics were delighted, because they didn't know I was looking at this particular topic that I read. Now what happened was, the report went viral, and the head of department of the RMIT chiropractic 3 weeks later stood down. A few months later he resigned from the RMIT to be appointed to the board of the Chiropractic Association of Australia. So that gave me a new area to look at. So what was this? Now this chiropractic association are the peak body representing chiropractors. That's over 1,600 chiropractors. Now I actually had a look at this website and the links to it. There was, indirectly, there was a magazine full of don't vaccinate children, full of supplications, full of all this kind of stuff. And I thought, well, what's chiropractic about? What's this fundamentalist chiropractic about? Well, back in the 19th century, D.D. Palmer was the founder and religious head of chiropractic. Now, he claims that he manipulated somebody's back and their hearing was restored. So then he said, oh, wow, this is great. All disease is caused by problems with the spine. You get these, you know, as you're being born, you get these traumas on your back, you get these lesions, and this is going to cause 95% of diseases. And that was his philosophy. In fact, when you look at some of these documents, brochures that come out, you have to take your child to the baby to the chiropractor 6 times before they can walk to be adjusted. Now, what adjustment means is they press on their little tiny backs and it removes these vertebral supplication complex, these lesions, and that lets the God's life force flow up and down between the organs and the spine. And that means the child's body can heal itself, and they don't need to be vaccinated, and they won't get sick, and if they are sick, they will be cured. Now, the president is quite happy to tell us, even on television, 1/3 of his patients are babies and children. And also, his wife has written a book called Well-Adjusted Babies. And in it, she says you should delay vaccinating your baby. In fact, you should use homeopathic vaccinations. So I was fairly sure that the Chiropractic Association, you know, had stayed in the dark side because a lot of them haven't come out of it. I looked at the other members of the board. It was the same thing. All of their personal websites were making these claims. Now, fairly soon after, I was sent a copy of a job advert for Central Queensland University. Now, up until this time, there was no chiropractic degree in my state. Queensland actually is the state of woo. And here we had it, at least it was fairly chiropractic training free. There was a job ad, and who signed it off? Well, it was the Chiropractors Association of Australia. And they were going to actually, looking for a new head of department, they were going to interview them, they were going to set this degree up. So of course the ringing bells were going hugely that this was going to be another university that was embracing the dark side. So I contacted the professors and I said, look, we've got an issue here. We've got the skeptics have identified something like 18 or 19 universities, the number's gone down since then, that have embraced pseudoscience, and here is yet another one that puts us roughly at 50%. We have to do something. And they said, how do you know it's going to be pseudoscience? And I said, well, the people running it, the CAA, the ones setting it up, they're signing everything off. And they said, well, you know, find out who's going to run it. I said, I'm sure it's this turkey from Victoria. I'm sure it's him. He's coming my way. I'm not very happy about this. This is my state. And as it worked out, it was about November, we found that this same guy had been appointed to the position. So I went back to the professors. You know, by this time I'm near hysterical. I said, we have to do something. What can we do? John Dwyer said, I'll write a letter. So he wrote a letter to the university asking them to rethink their course. We had 30 professors sign that letter. Now we knew the university was probably going to ignore us, but of course we sent it to the press, and we got a lot of press on that as well. And that put the university on notice that these things were happening. In fact, there's a lot happened after that. We tried to get to all the vice chancellors to ask them to put science ahead of all the money they were getting in. We didn't quite win that one. But in reality, the formation of this group, after we sent the letter, we thought, we've got to get more organised. The alternatives are really well organised. The Chiropractors Association have got $4 million in their bank. We have to do something. We may be able to get some of the best brands in our country to help us. So, going to set up an empire. Yes, what do you call it? So, between us, we've got three professors in Adelaide, there's one in Sydney, and I'm up in Queensland, so we had to come up with a name. Friends of Science and Medicine, we all kind of like that one. Now, I think you'll like our logo. If you notice, that's Australia up the top, so we had a bit of a sense of humour there. And then we thought, well, there's only five of us. How are we going to structure this? And we thought, okay, what we can do is set up subcommittees doing various projects. And we thought that way we can push it down. If we've got 100 professors, we've got 30, we're sure to get 100. We can get them and recruit their mates to try to do some of this project. So we thought, okay, it's achievable. Now this was getting towards the beginning of December. Now you do not approach an academic at the beginning of December. They're flat out with students and exams and all the rest. But the day comes when the last exam paper gets marked and thrown away, and what are they going to do? Feet up on the table, glass of wine, relax, they might read their emails. Also, the press go on holidays till mid-January. Now when they come back, they are hungry for an easy story. So we thought, we have a month in here that we can try to launch ourselves. If we fail, we're fine, but we can give it a go. So maybe we were having a few wines ourselves when we made this decision, because we thought, we'll go for it. Now the professors know heaps of wonderful people, and they go to a lot of Christmas parties. So their job in recruitment was talking to their colleagues. Myself, on the other hand, my job was to look at how I could recruit professors, associate professors, academics. Well, bless their little wonderful hearts, a lot of the university websites have email addresses on them. So I did a mass recruitment campaign, emailing universities. I also looked at people who had got grants, who had won awards, and I sent them personal emails as well. Now, of course, we knew that they would know what we were against, but what are we for? So one professor had to sit down and write our principles and commitments, and that got circulated around until we knew what we were all about, because the press would want to know that. Between Christmas and New Year, I thought, well, I'll go get a website, as one does, to find I couldn't. You have to be incorporated to get a website with the .au in the end. So the next, another professor had to sit down and learn all about setting up a corporation, articles of association. And then we got the website. So I set one up, and the way I did that, I had two computers. One had the YouTube on how to do it, and the other had the system. I figured, 9-year-olds can do this, I'll give it a go. So I fumbled my way through and set up the website. Of course, by the time I finished the first one, I had a bit of an idea what I was doing. So the website was set up, and then I had to give it to the professors to work out what they wanted on it. So it meant that I'd set my alarm for 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning so I could make some modifications to it, while they, during the day, could come back with documents and circulate it around. So 5th of March was a really big day for me, because we sent our first newsletter and we launched the website. That was the first day of good rest. We didn't see Christmas, we didn't see New Year. This was 7-day week, 20 hours a day. If you weren't doing it, you were dreaming about it. One professor came back and said, we'd sent, between ourselves, over 3,000 emails during that first 3 months. I'm not good at this one, yeah. 3,000 emails, yes, that was a lot. We primarily targeted the scientific and clinical community, doctors and scientists, and professors of all sorts of different disciplines. We also targeted people that we knew were passionate about consumer activism relating to alternative medicines as well. Within the first 10 weeks, 500 people came on board. And this included some of the who's who, so this was just a brilliant response. Now we have 894 on board, so I'm hoping by the end of this weekend, I'll have another 6 people. We can hit the 900 mark, because I'll be sending it out. Very motivating. Now, we have a Nobel Prize winner, 2 Australians of the Year, and over 60 people who have been awarded recipients of the Order of Australian Medals. Majority of our members are professors and associate professors, but less than half are doctors. We've got some amazing consumers on board, airline pilots, you name it. Anybody can join us, we're more than happy. I'll be talking to you about that later. 19 organisations have aligned themselves now. I'll have to update this figure. Oh, over 70, that's right, over 70, because two more came on board yesterday, which is good, thank you. New Zealand, so you're here. The UK, the Zens Out Earth, Simon Singh, for those of you who know them. USA, Harriet Hall, Kimball Atwell. We've got Canada, Amsterdam, Norway, Africa, all people that have come on board to support us somehow, they've heard about us. Even South Korea, I've had a dialogue with a guy from South Korea who's worried about Chinese medicine heading into their universities. So it's not just Australian, I think you have fairly big problems here in this country as well. The one strength that we've had, we've connected with the press a lot, lots and lots of media articles, not just here, but in New York, the Times, and in the UK Guardian, and in some obscure Chinese newspaper, I saw that as well. Of course, there's been lots and lots of opposition from those with vested interests. Some of the projects that we're taking on, I've got these here as headings. One was universities, you can see that down there. We're still working on those. We're still documenting what's going on in them. We record the responses when they come back. We're still writing letters. We're discovering new, really wonderful courses in there. Our concern for universities and health funds is that they're government funded, or there is some of my tax dollars that are going into those courses or going into those therapies, and that really concerns me. Health funds is of interest, I'll mention that a little bit later on, that was a project I was given. Pathology test is very important. If you want to convince a healthy person that they're sick, we'll just give them something that looks very respectable on a pathology report, they'll believe it. Professional development courses is very interesting because you can have a very legitimate degree and the healthcare practitioner can graduate from that, go along to a government or a board-endorsed course and be exposed to a lot of pseudoscientific nonsense. So some other categories there, of course, chiropractic, which is my area. Pharmacies, you know, local pharmacy, 15 minutes for urology. You can have, you know, a diagnostic test there. They're hiring the naturopaths and setting up whole clinics in the pharmacies. And of course, there's the concept of clear your shelves and put in all these vitamins and supplements and, you know, take advantage of consumer sentiment. We have nurses who are putting crystals at the bottom of the bed to help with childbirth. We have midwives who are actually referring new parents to chiropractors for the babies to be adjusted. Osteopathy, cranial osteopathy, massage your head. It's going to cure your diseases, or, as they say it, help your body to heal itself. We've got GPs embracing the dark side. The Therapeutic Goods Administration, I still haven't let them alone. They're actually certainly on our list, and of course the big problem with unregistered practitioners. Now I'd like to say this is what we've achieved. I would like to brag and say that, but in reality, in Australia there's our group. There's the skeptics who are incredibly active. There's individuals like Ken McLeod and his team who have stopped the AVN to try to fight the big anti-vaccination groups. There's some amazing individuals. There's Consumer Health Forum. There's even the AMA. So we are there. So all I can say is, since we set up, isn't that, what's that saying, the harder you work, the luckier you get? Right. A lot of things have happened. All right. Last year, the Chief Medical Officer was given $1 million in 12 months to look at 31 natural therapies, to the idea that if they were found not to have evidence, and this includes homeopathy, iridology, etc., that the federal government would no longer fund them for the private health insurance. So we're waiting for that. Macquarie University, one of the original three universities that ran chiropractic, have announced that they're shutting down their degree. University, if you looked at some of the integrative medicine websites, there were university logos on them, and university professionals were there with all their affiliations. Then a lot of those have been cleaned up now, they've been taken off. And even the website, the university websites themselves, have been taking off fairly dodgy stuff off their websites as well. And lots of things have been deleted mysteriously. The Therapeutic Goods Administration, lots of reforms happening there. Well, we hope so. We've already sent in three different submissions, but they have a blueprint for reform, and it certainly sounds positive. One of the areas I looked at was professional development courses. I sat there for a month and went through 320 chiropractic courses, all attracting professional development hours, and one third made totally exaggerated claims or totally based on nonsense. Now I sent that in to APRA, the Practitioners Regulation Agency. Immediately the chiropractic board withdrew the list of their courses and they announced that they'd cancel some. So that was really good. The chiropractic board also put on their website, told the chiropractors that they had to remove any anti-vaccination stuff off their websites and out of their clinics. So that was a very positive move. And we're pleased to say there's choice. I think you get choice here, where they compared toasters and computers and all that kind of stuff. They put a brilliant article on chiropractic on the website, you can read it. Catalyst is a massive science show from the ABC, very respectable. They do astrophysics and they do all sorts of things on there. They ran a big show just in July on chiropractic, and these are both primarily exposing the vision of the CAA to be the, you know, the first point in primary care ahead of the doctors. That got in there. A lot of support from some really great journalists and the media as well, so that's been great. But we're not policing. We might be bits of watchdogs, but you won't find the professors and I tied up in chains in front of Parliament House. We're trying to work at a higher level. We're going to be slow, but if we can get the regulations changed, then the change will be there forever. The approach I've had has been very good in the short term, but staff change, things go backwards. The media has been terrific. We're starting to get a great stable of media. Good journalists who come to us and say, look, I'm doing what one yesterday, the day before yesterday, oh, I'm ear candling, what do you know about it? And we can then provide them with great information, we can provide them with experts. Because the one thing I've learned with journalists, they're very time stretched, their jobs are quite challenged. And if you can give them great information, timely, if they want it now, they don't want it in a week, they'll come back to you and they'll write better stories. So, and we have, with you know, Ian Fraser, I think you all know Ian Fraser, it's a Gus novel. We have some very impressive people that have joined us, and the media are only too happy to talk to them. Very hard to meet a parliamentarian, so we asked for an appointment with the former parliamentary health secretary, and we're given a meeting. She knew us, we were congratulated on what we were doing. Of course, after this weekend, when you think there's going to be a change of government, we've got to meet a whole bunch of new politicians. But anyway, we'll do that well. Now, the term powerful lobby group, that came off one of the alternative websites. And they were warning people about us, and I thought, I'll take that as a compliment. So we're now considered by them, versus us, as a powerful lobby group. And we're here for the long run. Even now, I took the professors there as enthusiastic now as they were when we began. And so that's... very positive to see that. Now, oh, here we go. The only requirement you have to join us, it costs us nothing, in fact you get a free newsletter delivered to your email basket every 3 or 4 months, is that you support our principles and commitments. That's the only requirement. We're not an exclusive group. We may have started with the professors, and that's primarily for the image for the press. It's certainly not because of any bias. You can find me here. There's my email, but if you look to the website, there's links to me there as well. But of course, you can go for gold. You definitely know where to find me. So if you have any questions, I'm certainly happy to answer them.
Okay, do we have any questions for Loretta?
I'm interested in the question of sort of the dark empire strike effect. Have you had put up much personal attacks or legal challenges? If you could pitch comment, please, on the whole issue of the strike effect. Thank you.
Now, the one thing I've been told by the professors, right, I have run my own stuff, I've always been my own person, even though they say the skeptics who do this is usually me. The only thing that professors ask me not to do is name names of people and organisations, because that's how you're going to get sued. Because if we got sued, we probably have to disband, and they would know that. Our budget was $125 each when we started, and we've been given a grant for $3,000 to get a new website, So we're setting up to try to do that. So we don't have enough funding to fight any legal challenges. So I know we've been very lucky. Someone complained about Professor McLennan to the medical board and they just threw it out. So far, so good.
Thank you. I've got one question. What's the friend's view on acupuncture? Is it placebo, bunkum, or something more to it than that? The reason I ask is I've got a nephew who's a doctor who's very sceptical on a lot of things, except he's crossed to the dark side of acupuncture. Possibly because he believes it, possibly because he's making good money.
Now, I can't speak on behalf of all the professors until they write a position statement, but what I can tell you is years ago, someone said to me, a hypnotherapist said, oh, it's easy, it's hypnotherapy with needles. And I've had that same belief since. But from our perspective, we have to stick with evidence-based medicine. So as that comes out, we can actually say that it doesn't work for this. You know, as you know, in acupuncture, they make all sorts of outrageous claims. So if I have any input, if the physician doctor will say that, it's just a placebo. But so that's my view. But as far as Friends of Science and Medicine, when we do come up with a position document, it will be available on our website.
There's an information flyer on the museum's website and resources on acupuncture. It's about 3 or 4 years old, maybe a little older now, but it's pretty much got some of the general research about two things that it's good for and the rest no.
Well, the two things that the evidence at this point says it's good for. When they put up this, like the previous speaker, the more research, good research they do, the more they'll find out.
Thanks, Loretta. The question is, are you aware of how natural health products and supplementary products bill that's just in the last stages of going through our parliament? I couldn't talk about this round, but just very quickly to say, a great idea, but with some nasty loopholes, anomalies, and exemptions that are going to reduce its effectiveness. But I just ask, are you aware of it at this stage?
No, I'm not. I'm aware that something's happened, but not the detail in it. But that's certainly something that the sceptics can look at here. It's never too late. I never say too late. Never say that.
I understand some of the health insurance agencies will pay out on these things. Have you had any attempt to go against the insurance company?
Oh, my goodness, yeah. Well, I think... health funds, second on the list. Now, yes, all but one health fund has some sort of quackery in it, and that health fund is the doctor's health fund, which, to get into, you either have to be a doctor or related to a doctor. And I'm actually in that health fund because my sister was a doctor. Because the health fund I was in was starting to support homeopathy or something, and I couldn't deal with it. So I thought, I've got to get out of this. And that's when I started looking at them to find that out. Yes, we started to look at that as a project, but when the chief medical officer was given $1 million, the primary reason for that is, I think there was 30% subsidy for the government to health funds, and the view was to stop that subsidy. So we have to wait until that review is completed before we can take them on again. But we've written to them, are you going to abide by the umpire's decision? So on. But get all the waffle, oh, this is what our patients are asking for, our members are asking for. So I think we'll have a lot more, in a better position to tackle them when this CMO, Chief Medical Officer's review comes out. I'm chomping at the bit on that one. That's really quite upsetting because from my own personal experience with that. I just object to the fact that my tax dollars a pain for somebody to go to a homeopath. I'm really not happy about that. Very important.
Okay, we'll just have one last question.
Thank you very much, Loretta. I find your speech very exciting and inspiring. As a health professional, I think it's great that you go to the media, but we find that can be a two-edged sword because the public support for things like osteopathic and chiropractic ACC funding is very high. Snipping babies' tongues because they apparently can't suckle properly is very common and popular in New Zealand. Amber teething necklaces are really popular. Do you find that actually the public response to media can be negative?
Oh, most definitely. Oh,
and can it oppose your purposes, I suppose.
Yeah, well, Auntie Sue or whatever her name is, she's all the one you get your health advice from. I mean, we've all done it. Somebody that we know and respect gives us advice. And we don't want, you know, bless our wonderful hearts, we don't want to change the way that we think. I mean, who hasn't taken vitamin C sometimes in the past to stop getting girls? Yes, that is a problem to us. But what I tend to do is sow the seed of doubt. Very powerful tool. If my friends are taking particular remedies, I would just give them the research and say, well, you might want to have a look at, you know, what the science said, give you another opinion. And that actually has worked most of the time. The gentle way. My initial way was to openly attack them after a few wines. In fact, I still do that. But when it comes to someone that is really a true believer, I'll just say, well, you just might want to have a look to see what the science is saying. And that helps them as well.
Okay, thank you very much.
Right now,